the unpredictable reef-strewn Caribbean once sailed the legendary galleons of the Spanish treasure fleets. Of the $10 billion plundered from the New World, more than $600 million in bullion and precious stones plunged to the bottom of the sea. La Nuestra Señora de la Concepción sank on November 2, 1641, taking to a shallow grave a king's ransom in gold and silver treasure. 327 years later, on the treacherous Silver Bank, some 85 miles north of Old Hispaniola, the men of Calypso begin one of the most challenging adventures in their undersea odyssey. They search for the Nuestra Señora and $1 million in sunken treasure.
When men hunt for sunken treasure, they will always discover something. Sometimes the treasure, sometimes not. But whatever happens, they will surely discover something they never knew before about themselves.
More than $50 million in sunken treasure remains unrecovered somewhere in the Caribbean. $1 million alone in the shallows of the Silver Banks.
Bon, on va y arriver. Top. Bon, alors voilà, nous sommes arrivés par ici, comme cela.
We are proceeding to the Silver Bank. My friend, Rémi de Hénin, soldier of fortune, entrepreneur and treasure hunter, led me here. He claims that he may have located the remains of the famous treasure galleon, Our Lady of the Concepcion. I have promised Rémi we will investigate the area for no more than 1 week.
Rémi de Hénin pilots Calypso through the dangerous shoals of the uncharted Silver Bank, first called Abrojos, meaning keep your eyes open. Here, at least 30 known ships have prematurely met their fates on the eviscerating knife edges of barely submerged pinnacles of coral. Captain Caillard carefully reviews with Sirot the final treacherous approach to the location Rémi has charted. The ship's launch sets out to mark the narrow channel with sea buoys. They will serve to guide the helmsman to a safe anchorage, hopefully within yards of the long-lost treasure galleon. Entry in the logbook of Calypso on July 13th. The search for treasure at Silver Banks begins. Diver, cameraman, and launch pilot make up the exploration team. It is 11 a.m. The sun is bright. The water clear for the 50 feet to the bottom of the reef.
near the surface on the windward side of reefs. Coral can grow at the rate of 1/2 inch a year. It is conceivable then that in the 327 years since the sinking of Nuestra Señora, 10 to 12 feet of coral may have forever sealed up the vessel. Therefore, I have asked Delmotte to concentrate his search on the desolate leeward side of the reef. Here, coral will only flourish if it can attach itself to foreign objects.
For nearly an hour, the launch tows Delmotte through the silent depths of the Spanish Main. On board Calypso, Cousteau, Remy, and the crew and divers await the first report. But all is negative. An amazing and unbelievable 55 minutes after Delmotte begins the search, he finds what Remy said he would find. Apparent evidence that a sailing vessel had long ago sunk at this secret site on the Silver Bank. It is a ship's cannon, similar to the armament once used to defend the galleons of the Spanish treasure armadas. Cameraman Delwaye immediately surfaces to report the discovery. Cousteau decides to personally explore the discovery site to evaluate Delmotte's almost uncannily quick find of the ancient cannon.
We have carefully studied the tides and winds of the Silver Bank. Once below, Remy and I sense almost immediately the direction in which the wreck must have been moving before striking the reef. We agree to separate, to seek out the perimeter of the wreck site. At the same time, the exploration team immediately begins to mark and map their individual finds.
Topside, the launch crew cranks to life a fire pump attached to a water jet. The diving team immediately begins a preliminary clearing of sand and silt. Cousteau logically hopes to discover fragments of the ship's timbers, which will help him to accurately identify the wreck. Next, the mini airlift teams begin soundings, digging exploratory holes in the area around the wreck. The team hopes to produce evidence which will aid Cousteau in solving the first mystery, to determine the perimeter of the collapsed galleon. In the meantime, the mooring crew uses the jagged coral teeth of the deadly reef head to secure Calypso. Remy, anxious to find corroborating proof that the wreck is definitely the treasure galleon, continues his search just below the crown of the reef. There he believes the gaping hole in the belly of the ill-fated vessel must have first spilled out its telltale cargo of silver and gold. Suddenly, Remy makes a discovery, which will trigger dreams of glory and fortune in the imaginations of the men of Calypso. They are ancient ship's cauldrons, the same kind of cauldrons which helped save the lives of the survivors of Our Lady of the Conception. According to the sketchy accounts given by some of the survivors of the Treasure Galleon, the night of the crash brought forth an ingenuity born of desperation. Huge cooking cauldrons were hauled from the settling ship onto the reef head, submerged in knee-deep water. The discovery of the cauldrons brings ghostly images to the imagination of the men of Calypso. The panicky gathering of broken ship's timbers and food supplies. The first terror-filled nights when signal fires were kept ablaze in the cauldrons. The hopelessness before the survivors rafted off to rescue or oblivion.
Remy's discovery of the cauldrons had given us cause to excavate the wreck site. I knew I could not disappoint my old friend and the excited divers and crew of Calypso.
But first Cousteau, aware of how gold fever can alter even the strongest man's character, cautions the men of Calypso. Excavating the wreck site will take relentless and backbreaking labor. The wreck may or may not be the Treasure Galleon. They must also agree in advance on how to divide the spoils if they should discover treasure or other artifacts of value. He has put the undersea gamble to a vote. Each man in his own way awaits the outcome of the secret ballot. The returns are unanimous. For the first time in the long voyage of the research vessel Calypso, the men and divers will hunt for sunken treasure. Date, July 24th, San Juan, Puerto Rico.
We must hurry. The Caribbean hurricane season is approaching. The men have worked night and day constructing the salvaging equipment we will need. Veteran Calypso comrade and world-famous undersea archaeologist Frédéric Dumas has hurried to join us.
Another treasure hunter preceded Calypso to the site of the Nuestra Señora by almost 300 years. They were under the command of a Yankee adventurer, William Phipps. Phipps was the first, most famous, and perhaps most successful of all treasure hunters. In 1684, while calling for supplies in the Caribbean, he found one of the survivors of Nuestra Señora. The sailor revealed to Phipps the location of the wreck in exchange for a share in the gold. With this unique piece of information, Phipps sailed for the Silver Banks. He had divers on board, Caribbean natives that possessed an extraordinary capacity for free diving. They would have to dive up to 50 feet, search a wreck already encrusted with 10 to 20 inches of coral, recover heavy gold, silver bullion, or coins, and return to the surface. All this in one long breath. Those of us who are trained divers can sustain three dives for 2.5 minutes or more, but it is exhausting. Repeated 10 or 20 times a day, it is body-racking. Nevertheless, Phipps divers recovered more than $1 million in gold and silver. The total was miraculous, but it was only half the treasure carried by the Nuestra Señora.
The men of Calypso have assembled a sophisticated arsenal of salvage equipment to find $1 million in treasure. First, the James and Mary, named in honor of William Phipps' salvage vessel. It will serve as the terminal point for a giant vacuum cleaner. An improvised float supports the hose that will reach 50 feet to the bottom of the reef. A special 200 horsepower air compressor supplies the power. Once unleashed, its roar will envelop the ship. For 12 hours a day, its throb will imprint itself on the mind of the crew. Through the airlift pipe will pass 50 tons of water an hour and 5 tons of sand, silt, and coral debris. All this must be swept aside to expose the wreck. Once in operation, the giant airlift will be treated with great respect by the divers of Calypso. It is so powerful it can suck up a man's arm. The airlift could literally suck out a man's blood through his skin. Waste sucked up from the wreck site will pass through metal baskets set in the James and Mary, 8-foot strainers to sift out sand and catch anything of value. Soon, all is ready, and Cousteau calls for a final inspection. A diver examines every inch of the 5-story airlift. The hose goes straight to the bottom from its terminal point, but the nozzle, the working end of the vacuum cleaner, must be set up far from the James and Mary. If it were directly below, silt and sand pouring out of the strainers would rain down on the divers, cutting visibility and filling the excavation holes, 50 feet to the ocean bed. Then it goes 20 yards along the floor to the first excavation. To the crew, from this day forward, the airlift will have a name. Seeing it in its entirety, they christen their temperamental toy, the Monster. An underseas lookout gives the signal, and a 20th century treasure hunt begins.
I have the impression that the suction pipe with a long flexible hose based on the principle of an airlift works pretty well. But they seem to have a lot of trouble with the ground itself.
Well, the ground is especially difficult for a suction pipe because it is a mixture of mud and coral with big lumps.
And you, Remy?
I think the same, but the problem is that it's a lot of material to remove and you need at least one assistant, maybe two on each diving team.
Well, we will organize the teams with at least one assistant.
At Ramey's suggestion, a third man is added to the alternating airlift teams to control the powerful bucking of the Monster. Relief divers exchange their footgear for scissored off fins, which are used as boots by the excavators. 20-pound belt weights help the divers to operate in fixed positions. Before the ascending team returns to Calypso for a much-needed rest, they turn over to the relief divers their helmets with built-in work lights. Each team works an hour and a half. 4 teams take alternating shifts. The work goes on without a break for 12 hours a day. Medium-sized pieces of material create new problems. unable to pass through the suction pipe. They are sent up in a steel mesh gondola. When the basket is filled, the divers inflate the gasoline drum balloon with a small bottle of compressed air. While the airlift teams have been working on the level areas of the wreck site, another team has devised a method of bringing on board Calypso, mysterious ton-heavy chunks of coral which stud the recovery area. It is Delois who named them Cannon Coral. He discovered these toadstool-shaped formations seem to go around large metal pieces, cannons in particular. Once on deck, a voluntary Alcatraz crew breaks the coral apart to reveal its inner secrets. Tons of coral produce nothing, but large or small, every piece of coral brought up from the wreck site must be opened up. Even the smallest piece of coral could contain a fortune in pieces of eight or precious gems. The enormous effort results in but a hope-sustaining collection of cannonballs and ship's rigging. Still, the men of Calypso are not easily discouraged. Voluntarily, they agree to live on short rations, forego showers to save water, so that Calypso can remain on station as long as possible. Such is the nature of gold fever. The first important aspect of hunting for sunken treasure is to minutely examine the few and mostly fragmentary remains at a wreck site for clues which will conclusively identify the age, nationality, and hopefully the name of the suspected treasure vessel. The potential outcome of the adventure and the extent to which the dangerous and backbreaking work will continue depends entirely on knowing as quickly as possible that the wreck you are exploring is the wreck you believe it to be. So with treasure hunter hearts, the search for clues begins. Thank you. Moving a mountain is all in a day's work for a gold miner. Making a mountain is all in a day's work for the treasure hunters of Calypso.
After 17 days of searching the wreck site, we still have not confirmed the identity of the sunken vessel, but we have provided some unexpected benefits to the inhabitants of the reef. Scavengers forage for sea worms among the coral debris. Bearded mullets seeking micromarine tidbits seem to emulate the Calypso airlift. The divers dig on, cheered by the arrival of their colorful and curious friends. Inadvertently, we dislodge tasty morsels from their hiding places. One brave and aggressive damselfish, however, we are not quite welcome. Our presence in her territory has lured a host of unwanted guests. She is determined to guard her ground against all invaders, regardless of their size. And that goes for the divers as well.
August 3rd, the deep digging monster reveals the first important artifact. It is a kind of pottery normally carried by sailing vessels outward bound from the New World. The crudely fashioned jug resembles containers made by South American Indians. They were used by mariners during the long Atlantic crossing for the preservation of foodstuffs. But most exciting is the fact that the pottery is unbroken. Inside the still stoppered jug are small vertebrae, a sign that the jug had been used for preserving fish. The divers have taken an extra precaution against injury. Brightly colored gloves serve as warning flags to the airlift operator. The excavators next turn up a syringe, commonly found in the pharmacies of the more sophisticated sailing vessels, such as the Spanish treasure galleons.
Coral clings to metal, and to strip away the last layers, Robineau applies a fuming batter of hydrochloric acid. The best comes last, a metal plate. Often on treasure ships, the table service was made of silver. All of us wait for the acid to reveal a bright and shining surface.
More tin and pewter plates are discovered by the divers. And then suddenly in the eerie world of this mystery ship's grave, the divers find fragments of bones. For a moment, there comes ghostly images of men who may have gone down with their ship. And then the sudden realization of just what kind of bones they are, soup bones.
Berdau is digging here near this gun and is finding remains of the kitchen and heaps of ox bones and pork bones. So we probably are near the galley in the forecastle. What do you think, Remy?
Well, it's quite true. The galley and the ship stalls were the forecastle. But part of the forecastle and part of the deck might have collapsed on one side, so to find the real hull, we have to dig across to find the heavy timbers.
Yes.
If we are above...
Cousteau, Remy, and Dumas agree that the excavation must take a new direction if they are to find the hull in which the ship may have carried heavy gold or silver bullion.
Anyway, we are not very far.
Oh, no, certainly.
Much like detective work, each new find provides another clue to the mystery. Time after time, the excavators unearth stacks of fragile cups and bowls, completely intact. They are set inside each other as if they had been packed in cargo crates. Based on this evidence, Dumas will set forth a theory. He believes the ship settled on her side when she went down. The crates, he speculates, must have been stored on deck. As the ship rolled on her side, deck cargo had slid off into the sea. It rested there undisturbed and unbroken. Fragile objects which remained inside the wreck would ultimately have been crushed by the rotting and collapsing ship's timbers.
As the divers bring the fragile cups and bowls aboard Calypso, we are again stimulated in our labors. The delicate tableware appears at first to be genuine Chinese porcelain, worth a fortune. We recall that at the height of the Spanish treasure armadas, galleons from the Philippines would transfer cargoes of Chinese porcelain to ships bound for Spain. Now we have porcelain. Next, obviously, we must find gold.
U.S. Air Force weather planes scour the unpredictable Caribbean. Their reports are useful to Calypso. Captain K.R. maintains a detailed weather map. And on the 15th of August, a dreaded storm breaks. He makes a crucial decision to stay on station, convinced that only the edge of the storm will pass over Calypso's position. The divers celebrate their first work break in 15 days by luxuriating their salt-sore bodies in the cool freshness of the tropical rain. For several days preceding the storm, the excavators had unearthed no new artifacts. Cousteau and Dumas inspect the cross-section trenches carved by the divers to the apparent perimeter of the wreck. The operation area is empty, save for the remnant planks of the ship's hull exposed by the digging. Cousteau now sees that the wreck is not a whole ship, only the forward third, where the galley had probably been located. Convinced that his theory is right, he signals to Dumas his belief that the ship had broken in two when it crashed on the reef.
Here are the guns and the front part of the ship. If it was 50 meters long, it was like this. But we know that it was broken in two, and the rear probably drifted in the storm and went to the other guns over there.
An excavating team with the portable and self-contained airlift immediately begins to explore a new site. Here, Cousteau believes the other portion of the collapsed wreck may be hidden under the drifting silt.
As our divers begin work on the new site, I sense there is something new in their hearts. It is neither dreams of glory or fortune. Rather, it is an ironic humor and a professional determination to wrest the secret identity of this ancient wreck from the venerable but inexorable sea.
Although Spanish treasure ships often carried French, Dutch, or Italian armament, Cousteau also decides to bring one of the wreck's cannons aboard. There is a slight possibility that the arsenal markings may shed some light on the identity of the wreck. The cannon reveals little. Inscribed on the cannon is only the cryptic code H225OA, but no date. Even had a date been etched on the cannon, it could have proven deceptive. Cannons forged in the late 1500s were still in active use up to as late as 1820. The recovered cannon does reveal one thing. When the ship crashed on the reef, its guns were loaded and primed for combat. A common habit of most ships' captains during the open sea days of pirates and privateers who preyed on cargo and treasure ships alike. The cannon weighed more than a ton and was capable of firing a mass-snapping cast iron ball weighing up to 8 pounds.
Our catalog of work is frightening. 18 days of back-breaking labor deafened by the constant din of the compressor. Hours of endless hammering and the sifting of 300 tons of coral debris. For all our effort, we have a deck cluttered by pottery of questionable worth, a cannon, and some cannonballs. In purely economic details, mad expenditures. In terms of human effort, incalculable output of energy.
À Clichy, il y a un petit gage pépère. C'est la locomotive qui va t'aider. À l'été, son petit enfant.
Still, there is hope. The fever of discovering. How brightly it burns. How few complain. Still, we have no proof that our labor may bring reward. And then there is a first piece of gold. And I frankly wonder if it is an omen of the future. A gold medal of Saint Francis of Assisi, patron saint of the poor.
The sharks, which had cruised the eerie gravesite of the wreck before the treasure hunt began, return. Perhaps they have returned because in some primeval way, they sense the time has come for Calypso to depart the Silverbanks. But to veterans of the Red Sea expeditions, the sharks are simply another variety of fish. In spite of the omens, or perhaps because of them, the divers are as anxious as ever to learn the true nature of the wreck. They have moved the monster to the new site, where the digging continues in earnest. Their determination is about to be rewarded. Suddenly, the teams uncover a cache of lead packing seals. Carefully and gently, the diver places the tiny seals inside his work glove. Packing seals had always been used by mariners to seal gold packets. They discourage cargo tampering, and more important, may identify the owner of the cargo.
I knew once again we had not found conclusive proof of the ship's identity. The fleur-de-lis in the design has been used commonly by both the French and the Spanish. The Latin inscription expresses the thoughts of all the early conquerors of the New World. Floribo quo ferar, I will flourish wherever I go.
Meanwhile, below, the excavators have unknowingly discovered the telltale clue, which at long last will affect the final outcome of Calypso's hunt for sunken treasure. It appears to the divers to be a bell clapper, but is in fact a brass weight that had been used on the ship's scales. In the century when the weight was used, the boards of trade of the various European maritime nations would check the honesty of the ship's weights every 5 years and inscribe on the weights the last date of inspection. Cousteau and Dumas inspect the diver's newest finds.
Ça, c'est un pistolet.
First, the fossilized impression of an officer's pistol.
Yeah.
And then a mold the ship's silversmith had probably used on board to manufacture spoons. Next was the remains of a handguard for a sword. And finally, the brass weight from the ship's scales.
$1756.
The hunt for sunken treasure is over.
We found this scale weight, and we know, because of the date inscribed on it, that the ship we're working on is at least a century younger than the galleon we hope to find. What nationality was that ship? Well, you know, we found a seal here, and I'm sure that specialists can tell us. Also, we found on this part an inscription. It seems to be Dutch. I'm not sure.
Looks like.
The ship was carrying a cargo of thousands of bottles, square bottles like this. Probably rum, no?
Yes. Very likely.
And hundreds of pieces of pottery. These goblets, these cups.
With gold fever drained from the atmosphere, archaeologist Dumas has taken time to carefully examine the cups and bowls. He concludes they are not Chinese porcelain. He surmises they would be classic European designs, with their conformations and decorations naively modified by the Indian artisans of South America.
All these plates, very curious plates.
Very strange design.
Which shows that the ship probably was sailing from the New World to the Old World. Very probably. I'm not sure yet.
August 25. 5:45 in the morning. The ship is still asleep. I feel strangely alone. My equipment feels lighter than usual. As I slowly sink, I can embrace the entire work area at a glance. We will soon be closing our treasure hunt. In 15 minutes, Raymond and Jean-Pierre will dive to their tasks. But now I am alone and at home in the sea. Today, objects have a new dimension. Time is abolished. Wooden planks, anchors, cannons belong to the Flying Dutchman. The suction hose is the sea serpent asleep. Water frees me from gravity and winks to realities. Here, success and failure become so much alike. Both have little importance in the end. And I feel today how much my own approach to the world, to men, to society, how much all my morals have been influenced, then dictated by 32 years of diving.
When men hunt for a sunken treasure, they will always discover something. Sometimes the treasure, sometimes not. But whatever happens, they will surely discover something they never knew before about themselves. As men, it is revealed more in their eyes than in their words.
Eh bien, j'aurais acheté de la terre, beaucoup de terre, des collines, des arbres, un ruisseau, peut-être une vieille maison.
En fait, j'ai jamais vraiment pensé, jamais vraiment cru qu'on pourrait trouver un trésor. Ça me semblait quelque chose d'un peu...
J'espérais qu'on ne soit pas venu ici pour rien.
Mais... Enfin, sérieusement, j'y croyais pas tellement.
Je suis comme Saint Thomas, moi. Il faut me montrer, après, je crois.
Ah oui, j'ai toujours une métacarme, moi.
Je l'aurais bien employé, mais... On l'a pas avec un pied.
One of the oldest expressions in the French language is c'est la vie. That's life. Casually tossed off, the expression is deeply profound and at the same time ironic. A way of laughing at life when things have not gone well. A way of saying, life is short, so let's get on with it. It is in this spirit that Forcieri and Dumas salute the Calypso's hunt for sunken treasure. As the men look forward to their next adventure in the underseas world.
The ways of the sea, the ways of sunken treasure hunters, are as certain as the sunrise. In a few years, the tide-shifting sands and the coral will cover up all traces of our visit. Sometime in the future, another Rémy de Hénin, another Frédéric Dumas, another Calypso may come here as we did, with their imaginations stirred by the fabled gold and silver of Nuestra Señora de la Concepción. There would be no treasure, but perhaps if they found the curious remains of the James and Mary we left behind, they would laugh at themselves the way we laughed at ourselves. C'est la vie.